Good morning, everyone. Very warm welcome.
Stand by the mic.
Oh, sorry. It's lovely to all be here together in person. My name's Matt, and I'm going to be opening the service. Before we begin, should we pray? Should we bow our heads and pray? Dear Lord, as we come to this time of year, we acknowledge that we've got a lot of different emotions. Some of us are feeling weary. Some of us are feeling probably a little bit worried. We've got loved ones that we may not be seeing. Some of us will be feeling very excited, particularly the little ones among us. And some of us will probably be feeling quite relieved as we get to the end of this year. But Lord, in you we know you are constant, and in you we trust and we have hope. And Lord Jesus, we pray that you would be with us this morning during our service. We pray by your Holy Spirit you would fill us. And Lord Jesus, we thank you. And our service this morning is all about, are we nearly there yet? And this year does feel a bit like a journey, doesn't it? So what we want to do is try and bring some celebration and joy. And Lord Jesus, we pray by your Spirit you be with us. Amen.
Amen.
I think we're going to have some notices now. Katie.
It is good to be here together today. I wanted to show you something. Do you remember the day that Jane played the video of that making that lovely bowl? Well, she's fired it. But not only that. So, my question to you is, what would you like to do with this as a part of Andy's? Don't have to tell me now. Could you have a pray and a think about it? What that might be, what we might use this bowl for as part of Andy's. We're very lucky to have so many of you, are so gifted anyway, but that just felt like a little bit of glory in what has been quite a dark time. I'm going to leave it at the front. The other thing to say is that I'm taking a bit of time off over January. It's been a very, very hard few weeks for everybody. And I think Matt said, where's Matt gone? There he is. You know, that weariness, it's that relentlessness that's happened, hasn't it? And so I'm taking a bit of time off. I'm leaving Joan Rowe, in charge of Andy's. So if you've got any questions, then please defer to her. We've used what we've been praying about, what Janet and Andy. I married a couple yesterday who were called Luke and Lacey, and I actually managed to call them Lucy and Lake in the middle of it. Anyway, they had a lovely wedding and they laughed, so it was fine. But Janet and Andy have so beautifully scripted all the things that we've prayed about. So we thought that it would be really good to run services in January over what we have been praying about, what's come out, what's your visions, your pictures, and your thoughts that have come out, what God is leading us to. So I will let you have a picture of, you know, what we're going to do in January, and I shall be back for that last Sunday in January. And we thought, it's being Candlemas, that we would have a Christingle. Yay! So if you've got friends who you'd like to invite to the Christingle, then please do so. And we will have that last, at that Andy's will be a Christingle. But one thing that came to me through good old social media after last night, and I know many of you, like me, are grieving things that are not going to happen. And this was written by a lady called India Knight, who writes for The Times, and she has written, "So it's not non-Christmas, it's freaky Christmas. And it's certainly a Christmas none of us, wherever we are in the world, are going to forget. But it's not a time for doom. Christmas is about light, being born into darkness, and that matters now more than ever." And that just has lifted my soul. The thought, keep focusing your gaze on that light, as Matt said. And I'm looking forward to sharing Christmas with so many of you over the next week. And after that, as I say, I shall be away. Well, I won't be away, but I'll not be here. I'm going to hand over to Ian. He's just got a message about a course that he and Helen will be running, or helping run.
Thank you. We're going to look forward to next year. Being a parent, as we all know, is quite a tricky thing, isn't it? And they don't come out with a list of instructions. But Care for the Family have written some. And we're hoping to lead a course on Zoom, and it's called Parenting Teenagers. And we're going to be covering a raft of subjects, including their emotional needs, temperaments, how to parent in a digital age. And I'll hand you over to Ian for a bit more.
So, the teenage years is for parents or carers of children between 11 and 19. That's who it's aimed at. And whether you're parenting together or on your own, we all want to encourage one another in facing the everyday challenges of supporting our children in those social needs and emotional needs, behavioural needs that Helen was referring to. There are 8 weekly sessions on Zoom. We'll start them at 8 p.m. and including a short refreshment break and time for discussions, we'll always finish by 10 p.m. The first session is on Tuesday the 26th of January, and we'll miss out the half term week, so the last session of the 8th will be on the 23rd of March. Although we're doing it on Zoom, we need to limit the numbers so that the breakout groups are a sensible size for discussion. But if you're interested, do contact us. Andy and Char will circulate our email address to everyone on the Andy's email list to help you in that.
I'm sorry to butt in. Can I just give one more quick notice? As we need one more welcomer for the afternoon of the 24th, and we need, I think, 2 welcomers for Christmas Day. So I realise not everyone's here, but if you could help, that would be brilliant. Thanks.
This morning's reading is from Luke, and it's chapter 1, and it's verses 26 to 38. And he came to her and said,
"Greetings, favoured one, the Lord is with you."
But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what kind of greeting this might be. The angel said to her,
"Do not be afraid, Mary. For you have found favour with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end."
Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her,
"The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the 6th month for her who was said to be barren."
Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." And then the angel departed from her. Now is the time that we're going to light our Advent candles. And Grace is going to come and light the candle. I'm just going to remind you of the meaning of this Advent ring. So the circle of greenery that goes right the way round has no beginning and it has no end. It's like God's love for us, which goes on and on and on. So the first candle represents hope. The second candle, peace. The third candle, joy. And the fourth candle, love. And the angel came to Mary and announced the good news. A saviour was being sent by God because he loved everyone so much. So there'll only be one candle left, which means we're nearly there.
This is time to listen to our first carol, and the words will be up on the screen. See him lying on a bed of straw.
In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them.
Thank you. So we're going to pick up the story with the shepherds, and so actually I need a raggedy bunch of old shepherds, and I kind of thought that could be us, like no offence, but if you can feel a bit raggedy and a bit tired because you're up all night looking after the sheep, and a bit stinky, but I also have got some honorary people here, a shepherd and a sheep here. So welcome, Raggedy Shepherd and Raggedy Sheep. And also Grace is going to come up and she's going to draw our story as we go along as well. So we pick up the story with the shepherds, okay? And in those days, apparently, like, people used to laugh at the shepherds. Like, they were kind of seen as kind of like the riffraff, like, not that important. And they were a bit stinky, as we said. Yeah, so, however, God must have thought that they were important because he sent them some really important news. And so I want us all to imagine. So let's imagine a nice warm campfire. We can all put out our hands, keeping our hands warm by the fire. And just kind of probably chatting and minding our own business and taking our job really seriously, when all of a sudden the sheep darted. They were really scared by something. They turned round and there in front of them, there was a huge warrior of light blazing in the darkness and said, "Don't be afraid of me. I bring you some happy news that is for everyone, everywhere." Okay, so that news is for everyone, everywhere. So this is your chance to open your envelope, your gold envelope, and see what that news was. So the news, has everyone seen, have they read the news for you? Maybe if you need an adult to help you read this. It says, "Dear precious one, I have special news for you. Today in Bethlehem, God's son has been born. You can go and see him. He is sleeping in a manger. Love from the Angel Express." So then, okay, you'd think that that was quite a lot for some unassuming shepherds in the middle of the night to meet an angel for the first time. But then they looked into the sky and they thought they saw a cloud. And then they realized it wasn't actually a cloud. It was angels, troops of angels armed with light. And they were singing a beautiful song, "Glory to God. To God be fame and honor and praise." Thank you for that choir of angels, as if from nowhere, amazing. Okay, at this point, the shepherds, they immediately reacted. So they stamped out their fire. They left their sheep, apart from our very important one. And they got ready to go, okay? So they put on their running gear. And they raced down the hill. They got to the gates of Bethlehem. They ran down the streets as fast as they could. They ran past the inn. And finally, they found themselves at a tumble-down stable. They were so excited about the news and they had to run straight away. And this story that I'm telling is from Luke 2, but it also comes from the Jesus Storybook Bible, which is brilliant. So I'm just going to read this bit. They got there and they caught their breath because they'd been running, they were hurrying. Then quietly, they tiptoed inside and they knelt on the floor. They had heard about this promised child, and now he was here, heaven's son, the maker of the stars, a baby sleeping in his mother's arms. This baby would be like that bright star shining in the sky that night, a light to light up the whole world, chasing away darkness, helping people to see. And the darker the night got, the brighter the star would shine. So once they had met Jesus, they then came out, and they were still hurrying because they were so amazed by the person that they had just met, that they told everybody, like everybody they could see, about the amazing news of Jesus. And there was a bit of a celebration and dance by one of the shepherds.
So now a song about what happened on that starry night when that shepherd got so excited. I wonder if the original shepherds did that particular dance. We'll never know. It was on a starry night. And their hearts believed again.
bells of heaven rang for him, for a boy was born, King of all the world.
Thank you. Thank you to our dancing shepherds. That was amazing. So the theme today is, are we nearly there? And as we near the end of Advent, the waiting is almost over. I wonder if you're good at waiting for things. There's been a lot of waiting this year, hasn't there? Whether you're good at waiting in queues or waiting for news, waiting to see somebody that you're really looking forward to seeing, waiting to arrive somewhere. Are we nearly there? That is something, a phrase that comes up quite a lot on car journeys. And we decided a couple of years ago to drive through the night to Spain. And so it took like 48 hours to get there. And the children just gave up asking because there wasn't any point because we were nowhere near where we were wanting to go. And leading up to the birth of Jesus, there were lots of people who were good at waiting. There were people who had to wait. In Isaiah 9, Isaiah the prophet speaks of a son, a born that was to be given, Wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. I wonder if he knew at that point that that promise was not going to happen for another nearly 700 years. Israel, the nation, they waited, they were waiting for the promised Messiah. The wise men were waiting for a prophecy to be fulfilled. They were looking for the sign of the star to show them where the baby king would be born. And Mary has this news that is life-changing, and there is a lot of waiting. Not only does she have the waiting of the birth of Jesus, but also waiting to see what this was going to mean for her and for her child. And then we have the shepherds. Now, I particularly like this part of the nativity story. There is no waiting at all for them. The angel says, comes to them and says, today the baby has been born in the town of David, a savior. They receive the news hot off the press. There's no waiting. And they don't hang around either. I love that verse where it says that they hurry to Bethlehem in Luke 2. They leave everything and they rush down to Bethlehem. They are excited to meet this baby Jesus and they are expectant of what's going to happen. And after their encounter with Jesus, their lives are changed. They don't just go back to their jobs feeling kind of ordinary. They are full of amazement and joy and they can't help but contain it. They tell everyone they see what they have seen and heard. And everybody who heard was also amazed. They continued, also those shepherds, it says that they continued to praise and glorify God. I mean, what a change in their lives, to know that they were important, to receive that news that was for them, and then to be able to encounter Jesus. And for us, the question, are we nearly there? The answer is yes, we are there. Like the shepherds, we have heard the news. There is no more waiting and there is no more wondering. We have, like we all had our envelopes, we each have our own invite to know Jesus as friend and Lord. In Matthew 19, Jesus says, "Let the children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to children such as these." He wants us to come to him. When I was 9 years old, I was in an evening service at the Baptist church where I grew up, and I just heard the words from the preacher just say, like, anyone can know Jesus. And like it was like these words would just came into my ears, and I was like, what? What, even me as a child, I can know Jesus? And so I went home and I spoke to my dad and we prayed together and I asked Jesus to be in my life. And it is that Jesus wants us, whatever our age, our background, anything. He wants us to come to him. He says in Matthew 11, "Come to me, all who are weary or burdened, and I will give you rest." So what do we do with this news, and what do we do with this truth that we are there? Do we drop everything like the shepherds and run to Jesus? There's no time for them to pick up nice gifts on the way, but they bring themselves with all that they are and all that God created them to be. Jesus longs for our attention and time. Again and again, I am challenged by the passage in the Bible where Jesus spends the evening with Mary and Martha. And I am challenged because I'm more of a Martha, naturally, of the doing and the being busy and wanting to seem like I'm there, here, there, everywhere for everybody and needed or impressing. And actually, what Martha needed to do in those moments was to sit at Jesus' feet and spend time with him and be like Mary and just be with Jesus. And do we, like the shepherds, do we continue to worship in every situation? What do you love doing? Is it football? Is it running? Is it singing? Is it drawing? Is it dancing? Is it music? Is it playing? Is it spending time with your friends? In all those things, we can worship and praise God. It's not just a church thing. It's an everyday and all life-encompassing thing. And there is a challenge too in there, to be like the shepherds and share the amazing gift of Jesus with others. They couldn't contain it. That joy and amazement of meeting with Jesus, they couldn't keep it to themselves. They naturally wanted to share. And I wonder at this time of Christmas and this time of reflecting on the year, but also looking ahead, are there ways that we can show who Jesus is to our friends and family? So, we've discovered that we are there. We're not nearly there, we are there. And in the present, where God is. He is always with us. He promises that he will always be with us because of Jesus, Emmanuel. So let's take a few moments to take this in, like the shepherd's response. Like the shepherd's response of running to Jesus. I don't know how you want to respond this morning, but we can come to him whether we are burdened and weary, whether we are excited and joyful, whether we feel like there's so much uncertainty at the moment. But with God, there is the truth of certainty and the truth of his love and his presence. So just invite you, it says in Psalm 46, verse 10, "Be still and know that I am God." So I just invite you just to close your eyes for a couple of moments and just be still in front of your God and just come to him with whatever questions or words or just your stillness that you want to bring to him today. Lord, we just thank you for your presence. We thank you for the good news of Jesus, that he is that wonderful counselor and Prince of Peace and everlasting Father, Lord. And we come to you and we want to stay in your presence, Lord. And we just thank you for that amazing truth that you are always with us in everything we do. Amen.
So let's take that theme of telling everybody that wonderful news into our last song, Go Tell It on the Mountain.
So, that's the end of our service. Thank you so much for being with us, whether you've joined us here or you've been watching online at home. Shall we just pray as we close? Lord God, just pray that we may go from this place today or where we are at home with that renewed sense of joy and hope, the Christmas story. Lord, you would fill our hearts again with that wonder of you coming to live amongst us. And Lord, whatever the challenges that we're facing over Christmas, the difficult things that life is throwing us, we just pray for your constancy and that knowledge that you are always with us. And finally, let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us together. Our Father,
in heaven,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, as we forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen. Thank you.